Yo, G, they can't stop me from rapping, can they? Can they hop?
What's up, everybody? Yes, it's your boy, the greatest E36 Unfiltered podcast. So I am back. We are doing a special edition with the 2020 NFL draft that just went by that was greatly affected by the COVID-19. So what better way to bring in a former NFL ball player who actually went through that same process, but his more traditional versus theirs, and give you the insight on what they possibly missed out and how they had to adjust to it. None other than my guy, my friend, my former teammate, University of Alabama, All-American safety, eight-year NFL veteran, Arizona Cardinals, and the Tennessee Titans, my man Rashad Johnson. Check him out. That's cue it.
Another opportunity, Father, to play a game that I love. It's actually, Father, just to be with us today, God, that we're focused, gives a spirit of power, God, of a sound mind, Father. Just lead our steps in everything that we do, God. Allow us to have faith, Father, in the work that we put in through the offseason to now. No matter what happens, that we will waver the storm, Father. We will come out victorious, God. I ask you, Father, for your spirit right now, God, to increase in each and every one of us. You've given these gifts and the talents, so now we want to give them back to you, for you to use them at your will, Father. This is your stage. This is all for you, God.
The man E-Gray, E36 Unfiltered Podcast Show. As you all know, we are doing a special edition for this time right now. We're dealing with the NFL draft that just passed here. So we got a special guest on the mic today, my man Rashad Johnson. Nine years, right?
I'll take nine. It was eight officially, but I'll take nine. You know,
okay, so you'll take nine. So we're gonna go to the official 8 years. As the NFL player with Arizona Cardinals, also Tennessee Titans, and an All-American out of the University of Alabama, two-time All-SEC first-team guy, Rashad Johnson in the building, man. How you doing?
Doing good, my brother. How about yourself, man?
Man, I can't complain, man. Can't complain at all, man. I'm getting more than blessed and happy to have you on the show, man, and this opportunity to be here and, you know, talking some sports game, man.
Yeah, man, I'm excited to be on your show, dog. You know, I've been watching you, you know, grind it out, do your thing, man. You're having some extremely big-time guests, man, that you had a chance to talk to. And I'm just, you know, humbled to be a part of the show now and just share with the fans, man. So let's have some fun, man. Let's chop it up and, you know, do what we do, bro.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I guess I'm sure you guys just heard about hired our sponsor. If you haven't heard, you're going to be hearing it in this interview, Anchor.fm. Again, Anchor.fm, that's how you get your podcast started. So if you're wondering how to navigate through that process, Anchor.fm, go check them out. Free to get this started. Then they'll guide you the rest of the way. All right? So let's jump in here, man. So this has been first of all, 2020 has been a year to be remembered in more ways than one.
Yeah.
So, you know, and we got to bring you on this show here, as we was talking earlier, you went into the 2009 draft. You were drafted the third round, the 95th pick overall to Arizona Cardinals. And you was able to have a more, I guess, quote-unquote, traditional process and enjoyment of the draft, unlike many in the 2020 draft with the virtual draft and everything. But there are some similarities. And with that being said, man, just take us through, like, for you, how you think you would have been able to how you would have navigated, and the difference you see from your experience when you got drafted versus their experience from this year draft, just from what you've been knowing and hearing and seeing with everything going on with the COVID-19.
Yeah, man. It was definitely, you know, unfortunate, you know, circumstances for these young men. You know, they've worked, you know, their entire careers, their entire lives for, you know, a special opportunity, you know, like the NFL draft, to be able to go to Las Vegas or go to Chicago or go to wherever they're having it. New York is, you know, huge for them, man. And this year, you know, with COVID-19, you know, wrecking shop, you know, across the globe, it's been, you know, everybody's had to adjust. You know, we're working from home. You know, we're doing Zoom meetings more and everything that we're doing. So I think for these guys, it was just, you know, the limit, I think it hurt more, not the guys who, you know, got drafted, because a lot of the guys that got drafted, my understanding is all the guys that went to the combine, you know, the 256 guys that actually attended the combine, each one of those guys were guys that had their name called for the draft. They got opportunity, you know, to go and showcase their talents. I think, you know, this COVID-19 really hurt a lot of those guys who, you know, were undrafted guys, because the teams didn't get an opportunity to go out and do pro days. They didn't get an opportunity to bring them into the facilities, you know, for those one-on-one interviews and get a chance to know these guys who, you know, are borderline players. Like, hey, we see some flashes about them, but maybe they just didn't play enough at this school. So we didn't get a chance to really be comfortable to draft them and pull them in. So I think for some of these, you know, guys that were undrafted guys, I think the COVID-19 may hurt them a little bit more than it did, you know, the first round in the higher end guys, because I mean, those guys' talents were shown and the abilities were there, and then they got a chance to showcase it at the combine. But these other guys, you know, were kind of lost in the wind. And for me, you know, my journey was as normal as it gets in terms of the draft, man. I went to the combine. I got a chance to go on some visits. You know, I went to Philadelphia, if I remember correctly, the Denver Broncos as well. But, you know, sometimes those meetings mean something and sometimes they don't. You know, I was drafted by the Cardinals. And I, you know, didn't have any idea that they were interested in me. So
you never met with them or nothing?
Now, we met at the combine. But at the combine, man, you kind of go through a little process of just meeting a little bit of everybody there. You know, everybody wants to get a little prick at you when you're at the combine. Yes. 5 to 8 minute, you know, kind of interviews, and they're just buzzing you from one room to the next. So I definitely got a chance to meet with the Cardinals, but it wasn't like them bringing me in for a second visit, or the Falcons who came to the University of Alabama and actually worked me out. You know what I'm saying? So they worked me. So when you get those type of, you know, opportunities, you really think that team is interested in you. And sometimes it's just, they're just trying to fill it out and see if it comes down to it and you're available, they may draft you, but they may not have, you know, really had you on their board at all.
Okay. You know, this brings a very interesting question. I want to follow up with that. With that being said, now that you are out of the league, you're done, you're retired, you don't put your work in with the team, you can be real transparent. So if you had to do it all over again, and you never knew who, of course, you didn't have a clue who was going to draft you, or they would ask you, or better yet, looking back now, out of those teams that did work you out and you had conversations with and things of that nature, who did you want when you kind of more like, ooh, that would be nice, I can go here, I'd like to get to this spot. What team would that have been?
Then in 2009, I really didn't know. You know, I kind of got what I wished for then, because I said I didn't want to go to a team, you know, that was really cold, because all I could remember is watching games and, you know, it's freezing cold, Buffalo or, you know, really? Green Bay, even though Green Bay has the legacy of winning, you know, it was just, I wanted to go somewhere it was warm, and I got my wish to Arizona. But now, say a guy that's that has played my 8 years and now retired, if I could go back now and say, with the mind that I have now, and I would say, hey, what team would I want to go to? You know, where would I want to play? I would want a big market, man. I would want to go to the Cowboys or to the Giants, you know, somewhere that's going to give me an opportunity to not only collect on the field and with my play, but collect off the field, man, you know, with my personality. You know, my giving to the community, you know, those opportunities and, you know, the media and the buzz that comes behind those big cities is huge for you, because you can do so much with your brand and the way the world is going. You know, I think that would be, be tremendous. You know, I think Xavier McKinney, actually, just to hit on a guy, safety, former guy at the University of Alabama, just went to the Giants. I think it's a perfect opportunity for him, man. He's a great football player, great young man. And when it's all said and done, he's going to be a guy that's going to make more off the field than the field that he made on the field, because he's in New York.
You're right. You know what? I believe that, because Landon Collins just blew up. Like his off the field presence, his different style and swag, everything just like blew up when he went Odell. You know, same thing. So you that makes a very, very, very good point. Now, going to that now, you said, you know, you kind of looked at the process that you went through and your team. What is one of the things here, and I think this is very, very critical, because not often do, you know, they see the light, they see the draft pick, they see the night with your family, then the after party, all this stuff. But those small, important things that help you even start out the block with a good chance, and I look at that as being an agent. Mm-hmm. Finding the right agent the appropriate agent for you and for your career, for your personality, for you. What was some of the non-negotiables that you went through when you searched in the search for an agent for the next level?
It's a tough process. You know, these guys are going to have a lot of different people coming at them with a lot of different, you know, opportunities that they're going to say that they can do for them. For me, I had to look at, you know, some of the track records of the guys that you know, I was interested in. That was one, understanding, you know, what they had done and the guys that maybe they had worked with and the relationships that they had, understanding that, you know, this thing is about relationships. Who do you know on the other side as well? And then from there, understanding, you know, who am I talking to, the guy, you know, like I don't like these agents sometimes are so big that they have people, you know, working underneath them that you're always communicating with the second guy. And for me, it was very important that, you know, I could talk, you know, to the guy. And then, you know, third, I think would be, you know, who's interested, you know, solely in not just my play on the field, because my play on the field is going to affect their pockets. You know, the more I can play, the more I can do, but who can, you know, also say that they're here for me off the field. You know, the agent situation is crazy. I had a couple different agents throughout my career. So I didn't get the decisions right, you know, always every time. But you know, the agency that I'm with now is tremendous, and I'm extremely thankful for them.
Okay, so the agent you with now, is that the same? Was he also with you during a portion of your actual playing career, or you completely got a different one from your post career versus playing career?
Actually, they came on around the closer to the end of my career, speaks volumes to, you know, what they do for me now, considering the things that you see in terms of the Hibbett Sports and the different activities you get opportunity to see on my
signings
and things of that nature. You know, they've assisted me in a lot of those things. And, you know, I wasn't even a primary guy that was with them my whole career to bring them the revenue on the big end that they probably wanted from me. But, you know, I think that goes a long way to say, you know, your character means a lot, because, you know, these guys are some guys that I said no to early on in my career and then came back to them on the back end to say, hey, you know, I need some help, would love to be a part of your agency. And, you know, they welcomed me. So I think how you say to people, you know, how you carry yourself, how you said no, and how, and, you know, when you don't agree at that point in time, you know, says a lot. So for me to, you know, for them to welcome me back says a lot about, you know, their values, their heart, and, you know, how they really care about their guys. And it also just says a lot about myself as well to be able to say them no. And then they were able to come back and accept me as well and say, you know, this guy still has value and we want to help him continue his career, post-career. So extremely thankful for Sports Trust.
He got the plug, Sports Trust. So there it is, got the plug for them. The biggest thing that you always hear is players, when they come in the league, what they buy when they first get in there, and how they blow this money at the post career, like this. So, you know, that getting money. So, you go on because, like, we, like, for you guys do not know, me and Rashad played against each other in high school. High school. Yeah, I hit him up for $277.
Fast.
So he was a young gun at the time, but no, we played ball at UA together. Now I'm gonna get back and get into that. But as far as now, you go on there, we know we get those monthly stipends. You know, we're like, okay, good, we straight, we was eating off of that, doing good, you know. But then you go from just having a few hundred dollars in your account, if that, to now you got up to millions. Hundreds, you know, millions of dollars in your account, managing that. So this from a little lighter side, take us back to the first purchase, like the first two or three purchases you made that you like, man, this is so dumb. Why I do that? Like the now you looking back now, like, okay, why did I buy that? What do you remember? What was that for you?
For me, it would be two things. One was buying a brand new car. I would never buy a brand new car. Like I actually bought a used car. My first car was a used Range Rover, which was an excellent purchase. And then I got kind of like excited about, okay, I did the right thing. Then I went and bought a brand new Camaro, which I still have. It's 2009.
Okay.
So only got 48,000 miles on it. So like I've taken care of it.
48,000, that's it?
Oh, that's it, bro. That's it.
So you ain't even driving that much.
Yeah, you know, it was my car, and I kind of got in and just, you know, cruised the streets to get away, you know, to Arizona, the sunshine, to enjoy it, man. That, and I think the second thing would be, you know, handling your finances in terms when it comes to family.
Yes. You know, take us through that trip.
I mean, you know, people are going to ask for things, you know, friends, family, you know, loved ones, people you've never heard of, people that, you know, you have been around for a long time. It's going to come, from all different areas. I think, you know, you need to be very comfortable saying no very early. If you're not comfortable saying no, finding someone in your corner who can say no. And then, you know, in terms of family, you know, whether it's you have kids or if it's parents and things of that nature that you want to help, you know, I think the better way than just giving finances is to set up, you know, a plan with, and through that plan you invest, and from that investment, you know, they get paid dividends that way. So you can understand that money now can last long term instead of giving lump sums of money to, you know, different people. And then from there, they may not understand how to process that, you know, and they may spend it. So from there, you're having to go back now and repeat yourself. So finding a way to set up barriers that can protect you and provide longevity for you, because at the end of the day, man, this is going to be a short window of time you know, you young men are going to have. The average lifespan is 3 years for an NFL player. Mm-hmm. You know, I was able to play 8. You know, I didn't make $80 million, but I made good money, you know, to live a life afterwards and to enjoy. I've got to have another career. So in order to do that as well, you have to invest and protect your money as well. So for these guys, they got to understand everything that I get, I need to be looking at how do I invest it to make something off of that. So long term down the road, you know, I'm not looking back saying, man, like I need those 8 years back. Or I need those 3 years back or those 2 years back, because you're not going to get it.
Yeah, Father Time will let you know, yo, I ain't got no more for you. This is our time, you know. Yeah. We're done. And, you know, and that's very important, man. It kind of segues into my next question is seeing the process that you guys, when you came in 2009, they had the rookie symposium. Mm. And so they took all the drafted players through that process. Mm-hmm. But since then, they have evaluated and changed the word. It's called the rookie training program. So now they bring in the drafted as well as undrafted. And why they do that? Because they notice that 55% of players that sign with NFL teams are actually undrafted. They actually end up signing as undrafted, which is a staggering, alarming number. So you was putting in over half the players into the league without any type of financial training, understanding of how to go from that much money to that much money and still be able to manage it with families. Let's be honest, a lot of NFL players come from impoverished backgrounds, where their families waiting on them to be the breadwinner and find this and that and this and all that. So that become very important. And so for you, how much value did you place in the rookie symposium? How important was that? And do you feel like they really did a good job of at least getting you guys started on the right track?
Yeah, I placed a lot of value in it. You know, I was a guy that was, you know, small town country guy, you know, played big time ball at Alabama. And as, you know, this thing kind of evolved, like I was learning on the go. So I was trying to eat as much information as I could and take in as much wisdom as I could, because I knew it was just so new to me. It wasn't something that, you know, was in the picture from the beginning. And as it became part of the picture, I'm like, I need to know more. So for me, I was open ears, you know, to listen to the guys that shared the stories. If I'm not mistaken, Chris Carter came for that rookie symposium in 2009 and shared, you know, about his issues in terms of, you know, off the field and his, you know, things that he had that caused issues, you know, long term for him as a player. But, you know, for me, I was open ears, and I think, you know, those things are good. I think what makes them even better is, you know, when the guys are listening, are in tune to it, and finding a way to making them not just a segmented weekend. You know, I noticed the pros and rookie training program, I'm not sure what it's called now, but you know, a weekend is good. You know, I think 3 days is good to impart wisdom and to impart these tools to these guys. But being able to find a way to, you know, weekly, monthly, quarterly, to remind them, you know, to continue sending out these words, to plug into their minds, to let them know, you know, like these things are still ongoing. Because at the end of the day, once we leave out of those spaces, like we all know it, like where you've been a highly trained athlete at the University of Alabama, like you know what it takes to be successful in that craft. So as soon as you leave out of whatever classroom, whatever lesson, whatever mental, you know, leadership program they try to give us, you got that information. But as soon as you left from it, your mind went right back to ball. It went right back to training. It went right back to the to what was the alpha A1 thing, because you're constantly in that. So being able to get those reminders are always good, because you find yourself just constantly down this road, hopping on that hamster wheel, man, not being able to look around, because it takes that consistency in that craft to sustain yourself.
Got you. And so for you, what would you say were the most challenging thing when you first entered to the league that you had to adjust to? And what was the thing that, you know, it took you a few years to really understand not only the business side of it, but the football aspect of it? So for you, what was the most challenging thing when you entered into the league that you can remember?
For me, it wasn't nothing really challenging in terms of the football side. I think I thought I was well prepared mentally, physically, things of that nature. I thought it was a physical game, a lot more physical than college. So people may not can see that, but it's definitely a whole nother level.
Tell them. Yeah. Because everybody's ready.
Everybody, grown men, bro. Like, seriously. And that was the other thing was, the business side of it was the challenging thing. Because you walk in, because coming from college, coming from Alabama, coming from other places, you know, you have this camaraderie, these team, you know, you go to dinner, you go to chow hall, you go to tutoring, like you spend all day with these guys. They become your brothers. In the NFL, you know, I came in as a, you know, wet behind the ear rookie, thinking like after practice, we all about to go kick it, hang out, have lunch, and boom, guys right out of the door. Like, you know, I got a family, got things going on.
Really?
So you begin to see that part of it. Which is like, okay, it's a lot of individuals that's kind of collectively going after, maybe going after the same goal, but maybe not. So it's kind of like
money.
It's like, you know, who do I trust? Who do I guard myself? Do I open? Like, so you find yourself in that avenue of trying to navigate those waters and understanding, is this organization really trying to win, or is it really about other things that's going on here? So you find yourself playing this mind game, you know, sometimes with yourself, that I did, honestly. You know, when you're performing and your performance sometimes is outweighed based on other things. So it's just a crazy business, though. And, you know, you see guys get cut day in and day out like that, you know, it's a different guy working out on Tuesdays. Like, it becomes a real business, bro. It's like it's not just, hey, I'm hanging out, having fun, playing, you know, on Sundays. Like,
yes,
it is about my business, because you see out there on Tuesday, they're working out four DBs. It's like, hey. You know, at any moment, you can be gone.
You be that guy. Injury, anything.
Yeah. But, I mean, that's what makes it the 1%. That's what, you know, kind of gave me my edge. That's what, you know, was a lot of who I was. The walk-on mentality helped me keep that edge. Being able to understand that, like, everything is not given. Everything is earned, and it can be gone at any time. So that was kind of like my mentality all along, even in college, being a walk-on, doing that. So even when I got to the league, it wasn't hard for me to adjust to that part of it. But it's hard to sustain it for, you know, as long as you think you really can. Like, for me, I would have loved to play 10 years, but, you know, 8 years and, you know, my mind, my body, it was enough, you know.
So segue to that, you talk about your body and everything that's enough. And I always speak about Father Time. We see it happened to the greats. The greatest MJ was, Father Time said, you got to go. As great as Kobe was, the body just, we saw with our own eye, the body just breaking down and injury after injury. And it's like, God, this ain't the Kobe we knew, for God rest his soul. And you saw that, and it hasn't quite caught up. What's that?
So that boy still gave us 61 in the last game, right? Was it 61 or 51?
60. It was 61, I think it was. And said, Mamba out, and dropped the mic. You know, so you can't knock that, like, the heart of a champion is what he was. So you got someone who seems to divide a little bit, but they're still like LeBron. He's still like, what is this guy? But even him. So with that being said for you, do you remember the game, the moment or situation that where you knew mentally, like, or physically, like, it's over, bro. Like, I'm pretty much done. But even if you, because a lot of people understand it. I remember when I was playing my arena football league, my last season, I knew going into that season, I said, if I have another hamstring, if I turn my hamstring one more time, because you know that with injuries, a hamstring, like, always, I have one more time, but this is going to be it. But even for that, mentally, I was already, for me to say that physically, that means to my body, I knew mentally before then. I'm running low on this continuous cycle of this. So for you, do you remember the moment when it hit you in your mind, whatever it was, that's come, like, you know what, I'm about ready to close this down. I think it's getting to that time.
It was my last year. I'm gonna say it this way. There was definitely a moment. It came. I knew it was like being said, like God was portraying it to me. But I wanted to deny it. I wanted to hold on to it, if that makes sense.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So for me, I was my last year, I was having some back issues, some neck issues, which I'm still kind of just lingering things that are going on that I just can't find comfort in. So that was going my last year. So my playing time kind of had dropped, and I wasn't really just feeling as well as I needed to feel, man. I just was discomfort like the whole year, like really, really bad discomfort. And not only that, I was struggling with what the game had really done to me a little bit mentally in terms of, in terms of my play, in terms of like, you know, my time in my career. I feel like I did a lot of great things, but I felt like I feel like I didn't get rewarded for a lot of the things that I kind of given the game. So now I was at this point, which was kind of the end of my career, and I was really like having some really, really tough heart to heart moments with myself. Mm. And I never forget it, man. I was sitting in the car with my brother, and we were sitting out in the parking lot. At what's the name of that place we used to go to and eat afterwards? I can't think of the name of it, but I give it to you when it do come. Oh, Connor's. That's it.
Connor. Okay. Yeah.
They have an amazing duck at Connor's.
They still do. Yes, it is.
Yeah. Anyway, we're in the parking lot, bro, and we're just talking. Like, man, like he's like, yo, bro, how you feeling, man? Where your head at? Because like you know how the game is. Like when you leave a game and like you play at that type of environment, when you leave it, sometimes like it's hard to just leave it on the field because like you're thinking about the things that you've made mistakes that you're thinking about, like, oh man, it's mistake. But like you always evaluate yourself. And like I got to the point where like I was tired of that, bro. You know what I'm saying? Like I was tired of like evaluating the things I did wrong and like trying to like fix it and move. Like it was just and like in my mind, like I was just tired. I said, bro, man, like my body hurts. I said, my mind hurts. And I said, man, I'm just tired. And like, you know, I'm just tired.
Yeah.
He was like, man, like, you know, like, cause I just felt like, you know, I feel like I had to keep going. Cause like I had this goal in my head. I want to be 10 years in. I want to do this. Da, da, da. But I feel like in that moment, man, it was done. You know, my mind, my body had said it. But I think my heart, like, I just didn't want to let it go. Like, I just want to continue to hold on. And I think that was probably the moment for me. And I think when I finally released it and kind of let go of the game was in June, my little girl was born. So that off season after the Titans, I was working out, grinding, doing my thing, waiting on a call, never got a call from any team, never got an opportunity to work out for another team. But my little girl was born in that same season of time. And right then I kind of had like a revelation that, you know, it was time to do something a little bit more important in life. And, you know, that was be a father and, you know, be a committed husband at home, man. So that's kind of where I've transitioned into. And you know, now I'm excited to, you know, be an analyst and doing, you know, some of those great things too.
I hear that, man. You know, and that is what you just said to me was a major jewel, not only for myself, but for the listeners as it's going with in their mindset. I mean, you know what? It's because it is funny you say that because I never forget it. Now, I remember, I think it was 2013. Let me see. Cause you left Arizona in 20, you played there. You left there in 2015.
Yep.
And you played 2016, 20. So I think it had to be 2013. It's one of your, they had created a whole thing like Rashad Johnson for Pro Bowl.
Yeah.
One thing is, you know, you almost put, if you did lead, you were close to leading the team in tackles. You had 81 something tackles. I think led the team in picks. I mean,
yeah,
he was doing it. I'm like, and then you were still playing special team coach. You'd already been known for that. So I'm like, oh man, my man, gotta make the Pro Bowl. I mean, I went and hit the vote and everything. I'm like, come on, man, I gotta give it to him. And it didn't happen. And I remember thinking, like, I wonder how my dog feel, man, because I had just came out of playing not too long before that myself, I quickly understood how sometimes the popularity vote, it's a little bit out of your hands. It's about who got the contract, who the marketing, you know, not take any way thing from any players you guys had on your team. You had the Peterson, you had the Honey Badger, you had these names that spoke so strongly on you guys' team that often you can get even overlooked. And I'm like, man, that stuff got to be tough because it's not easy to duplicate seasons like that. You know, and I always wonder how they affect on people mental. Even though you get that, they say, oh, you're getting paid all this money. You good, man. You doing this, doing that. But they don't understand the right. amount of pounded you are put on that body, the off-season right. training, the how many no's you saying from doing this and doing that in order so you can get on the field and perform your butt off, you know. All that to see you come to that moment, because really what it sounded like you were saying, hey, basically, I just had mental fatigue of trying to overcome.
Find validation from the game. Yeah.
Exactly.
To validate my play. Like, I was like, I didn't get the Pro Bowl or the things like that, or stay with my home team that I kind of been there with and kind of rock with for a minute and kind of, did everything that you kind of want to do, play special teams, starting as a, fourth year guy, led a team a couple years of picks, did everything you want to do. You thinking like, I'm going to stay here, retire here. So like you said, just kind of had like a mental fatigue of just saying like, I'm mentally tired of trying to validate to you all
that
I belong. Like, I'm the player that I damn well know that I am. You know what I'm saying? So I'm done with y'all trying to, like, me doing this to validate to you all that I am that player. Like, I know that I am, and I don't need you guys to tell me that. Like my numbers and everything says that. And, so I'm gonna go on and I'm gonna do my thing as a father.
And so how was that transition for that for you? Now, how was that dealing with that call when you went, when they basically like, hey, we no longer need your service. Mm-hmm. Come on, Tennessee Titans. How was that? Because you spent years there. So that had to be a tough mental breakup, so to speak, even though you was kind of like, I'm done. But how was that moving on? And what kind of fire did that ignite inside you to go to when you went to Tennessee?
Oh, yeah. It was definitely a fire, that was lit, because, anytime you're a competitor, anytime you're working at your craft and you feel like you're good at something, and the team basically just, don't give you an offer and, don't really have a reason why. But the only reason why is they don't think you're good enough, obviously, if they don't give you one. So for me, it definitely lit a fire for me. I wanted to come back that next year, a better player. I had a couple of surgeries that offseason, came into the next year. Thought I, played well, didn't play great, but, played well enough to sustain, throughout that season. And like I said, then I started having the neck and back issues, but I just, leaving Arizona, it definitely was a tough breakup. I had a great group of guys, man, that I look at as brothers. And I think, sometimes, organizations and, and people, they evaluate talent. And I think that, Oh, that's cool. That's what, is a part of your job to do, is evaluate talent and make sure I got the best talent out here. But sometimes in team sports, man, camaraderie and willingness to sacrifice, for the guys next to you, overrides the talent that you try and put out there around each other. So I think, what we had was a special camaraderie and brotherhood that was committed to sacrificing no matter what for one another. And I think it showed, in our play and the way that we grew as players and respected one another, because it went beyond, between the lines. Like it was way out the field. We spent time together. Like, it went back to the college days. Like, we rocked.
Yeah. Okay.
So I think, and sometimes that gets, lost in the shuffle of business, and the NFL is a business. So we evaluate talent. We got to make sure this talent is worth the dollar that we're paying them. And if they're not, we got to go and get a cheaper talent that can possibly, surpass this talent that we were going to invest in. I mean, that's just the nature of the business. And I got bit by it, in that point in time. And I just, and it stung a little bit, and, now we're rocking on and, we're
being life goes on.
And I'm being able to pass this nugget and pass these jewels on to these young men, here at the university and at other places that I get a chance to cross, or maybe young rookies or young players that reach out and want to talk the game or talk ball. Like, I'm able to pass it on. Like, yo, it is a game. You have to understand that. And you have, to the best ability of yourself to come out as a winner, not only, physically and spiritually, but, also emotionally and mentally. You know what I'm saying? Gotcha. Don't let it eat you up there either.
Facts. It can't do that. It can't do that to you. So now you're going to the Titans and everything real quick. You got my man, Derrick Henry. You got a chance to play with another big cat in the running game. So, now he's dealing with, and you called the kind of the young version. Like, he wasn't quite the D Henry that he is at this point, exact point right now, or was putting off the yards and the stats. He's dealing with the contract situation, man. What's your thought about that? I mean, you think he's going to get paid? You think he should get paid? What's the deal? They're trying to franchise him.
They need to pay him what they owe him, but I mean, he he's getting bit by the nature of the beast, which is the running back.
The devalue.
They try and devalue. You get a lot of carries. I don't want to give you the big bag. So they're probably going to, you know, try and franchise tag him and hopefully hope that, you know, he can do it again this year. And I think he can. He has the skill set to do it, but they're probably betting it. And maybe he has a little bit of decline and we don't have to pay him as much. That's just the nature. That's how the business works. But what I do love about it, and he's going to be able to sustain himself because I never forget it. My first year there, you said I got a chance to play with Derek. Derek was a Heisman winner. Derek was a national champion. So you got to think when you come off of those type of things and you come into the NFL, you talk about the mental. He's ready to step in and play right now. He wants his opportunity. But unfortunately, that offseason, we just signed a running back by the name of DeMarco Murray to a big-time contract. Yep. So he's getting the bulk of the carries. He's getting the bulk of the touchdowns. And I never forget it. Like, Derek was going through it that time. He was like, man, I'm just really unsettled, you know, having some uncertainty of being, you know, with the Titans, things like that. He's like, you know, but he's having personal conversations. I'm like, bro, like you have to understand, this is the business. Like, the older guy, he's been paid. He's going to get the opportunity. You're a younger guy. What your opportunity for you right now is to get better each and every day at practice, take the snaps, learn the offense. And guess what? You're protecting your body. So now when the opportunity comes, you haven't got those hits early on in your career, which now he didn't get those hits. And now this year, what did he just do? He blew up.
Blew up
right into his contract year, and they're going to have to pay the man. You know, they're going to have to give him because, you know, Ryan Tannehill can't do what Ryan Tannehill did later in that season without handing the ball off to Derrick Henry and getting 8-9 guys focused on the run game. He's not that type of quarterback. We saw that in Miami. So don't think he's going to come up here and now turn into Aaron Rodgers or Tom Brady or somebody that can sling it around. He's not that guy. He's play action, get the guys running up, and let's throw the ball up top because he's got a big arm and he can, you know, he can make some plays with his legs out on the perimeter in the boot game. So don't think you don't need that big King Henry back there. You better pay that man what you own.
Talking about a vet, talking from an NFL vet, now they've been in the game. They don't the players do not, they're not, a business may devalue the running back, but the players, they know, like, you gotta have a running game. Give us, come on, we gotta have a running game.
No doubt. So, if you ain't got a running game, you better have a, you know, Aaron Rodgers, you know.
Exactly. You went to your process, and now you have transitioned into a sports analyst. If y'all don't see, he got the headphone on right now, the mic, he's doing it. Sports analyst and the player development and all that great stuff. Did you see this comment, man, and into your career after post-career?
A little bit, you know, and I think, you know, that goes to, you know, spending some time while I was playing to, you know, pick my brain on what are some other things that I kind of interested in. I had a opportunity to do a lot of media for university when I was here as a junior, as a senior, when Coach Saban first got here. And then when I got to the Cardinals, I did a lot of media for those guys as well. You know, the media would come, I would answer a lot of questions, you know, do a lot of the NFL network things. And I'll never forget it. Nate Burleson, he was on there, he was interviewing me one time, and I got finished with the interview. He was like, hang on for a minute. He was like, yo, bro, like, really good. You know, you answer questions well, good information. He's like, you need to go to this broadcast boot camp that the NFL offers and just see how you do. So I tried it out, and, you know, it was really interesting, and I enjoyed it. You know, it was an opportunity to stay close to the game, talk the game, you know, something that comes natural to you. And then, you know, just be able to share some of the things that I know. So to grow in knowledge and to share about football and to give people a different perspective, kind of where I see it and my viewpoint, I love it, man. And, you know, it's just an opportunity just to share the game in a different light. So I'm excited to work on that and, you know, become better at that craft and, you know, player development. You know, I've always been a guy that, you know, most people that play with me or been around me would say that, hey, he's a guy that kind of cares about the guys around him. Yes. You know, he's going to give what he has to them to help them, you know, be better people and make, you know, the best decisions moving forward. So, you know, to get an opportunity to be here at the University of Alabama and, you know, touch these young kids' lives, to help them understand that the transition is going to happen and make the right choices now to be in the right position once they do graduate. You know, I'm just honored, you know, to have that position, and, you know, that Coach Saban and them would trust me on their staff to be in that role, man. So just trying to knock it out of the park and, you know, and grow each and every day.
Dual threat, man. So would you say that you will say now that you will see yourself more so standing in that kind of a lane aspect versus, I know when you first came back, you went as a defensive analyst, kind of get a feel for the coaching aspect of it. Do you feel like you finally have found a home where you really want to, you know, plant your flag and with the player development and the sports analyst now?
I don't know, man. I think, you know, over time you just kind of, you change. Right now, man, I'm kind of in one of those modes to where I set my stake in the ground. You know, I started playing ball when I was 5 years old. And I think I was like 10 or 12. I was like, somebody was like, man, what if you play in the NFL? And I was like, not what if, like when I play in the NFL. My dad used to remind me of that. You know, sometimes you have those things in you that you kind of believe. So I had my stake in the ground and kind of drove after something for a long time. Right now I'm kind of, you know, I'm doing the things that my heart enjoys to do in those moments. Yes. And I'm not trying to like structure myself and say, hey, man, I'm going to be this. I'm going to climb and do like, because I don't want to get that mental fatigue that I had before. Right now, like, I think right now is a season of enjoyment of my family, enjoying my little girl, enjoy the beauty of just waking up, man, and having an opportunity to live life, man, especially in the season that we're in. COVID-19 is making us really slow down. So for me, it's kind of hard to label myself and say, like, I want to stay in player development. I want to stay in analyst. And what I can say is that, you know, I love football. So, you know, I love helping young men, and I love talking the game. You know, so the way that I'm able to do that, you know, if it eventually comes into, hey, you got a coaching opportunity here in high school that allowed you to do that, you still can be an analyst on Saturdays for Alabama, or hey, you can work here. Like, I don't know, man. Like, I don't know, but you know, I love where I'm at right now, man. And I'm excited to, you know, continue to be an analyst and continue to, you know, to help young men. And you know, hopefully, you know, it continues to grow and I can, you know, be who God called me to be. That's all I want to do, man.
Most definitely, man. Most definitely. And you will do that. So give us a quick insight. So now you have a chance to have the one-on-one conversation at the halftime, sometime in pregame with Coach Saban and everything. What is some of the size of Coach Saban that you have seen now that, because I know from a coach standpoint, when we were playing, you know, we got the side. Yeah, we got Coach Saban. But how much different it is from being his former player, from being a player of him, to now being an analyst when he do his sports talk and everything? How was that approach when you walk in the prison at halftime, knowing that sometimes he ain't always in the best mood, but how do you kind of approach that situation when you had to go up there and talk to him, knowing you know the inside of how he may be feeling versus, you know, okay, let me ask the right questions. How you navigate that? What's the insight?
It's always funny, man, because, you know, you can read it. His body language a mile away, like, you know how he's feeling, what's going on in his head. You know, I've had opportunity to play for him and, you know, be back here, so I know what he's feeling after the half and what's, you know, where he's at in his head sometimes. So I just, you know, I enjoy that opportunity to go in and, you know, and ask him, you know, the questions that I think, and I kind of try and bring my perspective to it and try and see if, you know, he confirms it or he feels another way, because, like, you know, as an analyst or as you know, a commentator in the game, I think, you know, that's our duty sometimes. So, like, say the half may have been, you know, we several turnovers in the first quarter, say it was the first game of the season, you know, hey, coach, you know, several turnovers in the first quarter look like the first game of the season, but really settled in there in the second quarter and began to run the ball well and got a 14-point lead. What are your thoughts on the half? You know, I kind of always leave it open-ended and kind of give my aspect or my take on what I believe was some pros and cons or what some things we can work on to see if he kind of agrees with it. You know, and then from there get like, what are your thoughts? So I leave it kind of open-ended for him to feed, you know, the information and that he wants to give. Because a lot of time, you know, there's always a message, you know, in the words when he's speaking.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
so
yeah.
I want to give him the opportunity to send that message, you know, to his team, to the fans that are listening. But it's always enjoyable, man. Just knowing that, hey, I'm coming in on Sundays after this game, I got to make sure this question is on point. You know,
exactly. Because I was more like, I know Sean still be around the facility quite a bit doing the player development. I know I'm going to have coach, you know, cut him in the hallway. Like, hey, I got you with the answer now, you know, or whatever, you know. Because he's going to evaluate. He's always, as we always know, he's always evaluating everything. Any and everything, whatever. But that's a cool insight, man. And last but not least here, double back here to your beginning, your humblest beginning, because now you got the walk, kind of walk of faith. What's your hashtag you do? Let me get the hashtag. It's walk of, let me go back to, I think I saw
walk of life.
Walk on life. That's it. Walk on life. Got your hashtags with that. And basically dealing
not
with
win.
A yeah. walk on everything. Now you got your doors with inhibits. But people understand, like, you came out of high school from Sullivan, which is a and you was ranked about like the fifth. I think I did the research. Fifth out of the 54 of your in your senior class. So a small class, only 4 miles from the state line of Mississippi. Yeah. You came on as a walk-on. You didn't have that one Division 1A scholarship. Or that you had Citadel and UNA.
Yeah.
And you chose, you said, I am going to take my butt to University of Alabama, the historic University of Alabama, well-known to college football ranks, but didn't even have an offer. How, what was it inside of you that first of all thought in your mind say, okay, I can go to Alabama, I'm going to walk on to Alabama, and I'm going to do my thing. Like, what was it about Bama? Did you always grow up being an Alabama fan, and what gave you that type of confidence to even make that type of a bold move?
Yeah, you know, being in state, you grew up knowing Alabama and Auburn. Can't say I was, you know, always an Alabama fan, always, you know, enjoyed watching the games. For me, you know, knowing the legacy of Alabama, it's kind of, you know, seeing a company or seeing something, knowing that, like, max return on your investment. Like, if I'm going to do something, like, I'm going to go all in and do it.
Yes.
And for me, you know, I love the game of football, and I'll just take you a little bit on a journey. You said UNA. I went to UNA. Just didn't sit well in my spirit. The things that I sat there, talked to the coach, got the offer. Okay, the Citadel came and offered me. You know, I don't make my bed up today if it wasn't for my beautiful wife. So I think I would have struggled at the Citadel, you know, trying to military regiment, and they would have got me, bro. So I was like, I want to have a little bit more fun in college. Just, you know, but anyway. And then, you know, I came to Alabama, bro. I came on an unofficial visit. I sat in the stands, and I was watching Alabama versus Tennessee. And, you know, it's something that I kind of, you know, live my life on, you know, even to this day, and some things that I'm kind of just navigating and, you know, in this newness of where I'm at. But I'm getting back to kind of that feeling of where I was then. It was something just in me, like in my belly, in my chest, like it was something leaping out of me. It was like, this is it. Like, I could feel it. Like, you're supposed to be here. Wow. You know, you can do this. So we got in the car and we were driving home from the game. And, you know, my dad asked me, he's like, you know, what you think? You know, blah, blah. I'm like, I'm going to walk on Alabama. Like, I'm supposed to go there. Like, that, I'm like, that's, I feel it. Like, faith. Like, I can feel it. I'm saying. And then, you know, I got the opportunity. They called, you know, and told my dad I was going to get the opportunity to walk on, or told me as well. And I shared the news with him. And he was, you know, excited. But at the same time, next thing he said was like, hey, son, you know, I've been working, you know, 18 years, third shift at this plant, you know, just got on first shift, you know, days, which is first shift, third shift is night shift. So he's been working there for 18 years, just got on days. I be to work at, you know, 7 o'clock every morning. He said, you know, Monday through Friday. He said, so there's a football field with a track around it in my hometown, our practice field. And he was like, hey, every morning I drive to work, I'm going to come and I'm going to drive around that football field. And he said, when I see you in the morning, I got to be there at 7. So that means I'm coming through around 6:45. He said, when I see you in the morning, you better be there and you better have broken a sweat. I ain't talking about like no light gray. It need to be dark gray, you know, V-neck.
So he's all the way there.
Yeah, get your mind right, you know, because he understood, man, you know, where I was headed. The opportunity that presented itself in terms of University of Alabama, like this is, you know, prestige in terms of the greatest college football program there is. You know, you want to be prepared for that type of opportunity. And that's what he was doing. He was making sure that my mind and my body and, you know, was physically and mentally prepared. Me not knowing, I'm thinking like, he's just trying to punish me, make me go up here and do more of this and that. And I just got this great news. But, you know, he was saying like, you know, the next level is going to take next level work. So for me, man, it was just a grind, dog. It was, my mind was always set on the go. I understood, you know, what had been sacrificed in terms of my, you know, my mom working two jobs, my dad tapping into his 401k to pay for my school. You know, I understood what had been sacrificed. So when I got to Bama, man, it was a chance for me to just showcase, you know, who I was as a player and who I was as a person. I wasn't letting anybody, you know, take that away from me, you know. So that's kind of what I am today. Like, I got some things that, you know, I envision and I hope to come to fruition at some point. But man, right now I'm just kind of grinding it out, and I'm moving with that, you know what I'm saying, that energy and that spirit of God tugging me, you know, and wherever he tugs me, man, I'm just gonna jump like I did, you know, when I walked on at Bama. So it's gonna be fun.
Facts, facts. That's what's up, man. And the last thing, shout out to you, man. I remember personally, I was your head of you, and you came out as a running back. And this is when I gained respect. It was on like a sweep, and they had you on scout team. And I think I had just came out off defense, and it was rotating. I was rotating the rotation. Anyway, they did a sweep, and you called the sweep, and it was really no blocking. This was actually in the stadium. Yeah. Like scrimmage stadium, and I'm not mistaken because you was there when Freddie was there. Yeah, yeah. I think Freddie's the scene, and they came down, and you didn't see Freddie. Somehow you didn't see him, and you made a cut back into the grain, and Freddie Roach just wow. You probably don't even remember it.
Yeah.
I said, oh shoot, God, and within everybody like ooh, within a second he was right back up. You pat him on the head and went right back to the huddle. I'm like, God, there's no blocking. They're killing him out here. But you kept on, but you were relentless. Like, you know, if I wasn't mistaken, you probably was even smiling. Like, it was relentless. You know what I'm saying? And then they got you on, you registered that year, got you on special team next year, and you would see the speed. Like, I remember he had to, I said, dude, that's a big feet. He can run. Like, he was getting it, and you were relentless. Yeah, you know, the bones on you. But he was relentless. Your relentless effort, man, to continuously do what you got to do to get on that field. And you just saw that steady incline on your progression, man. It's like, yo, this cat is going. Even when you and I came back, and I would say you were still playing special team and playing it like you had never, like you had, like that was your only chance to get on the field. But you was a starter by this time. And for me, mm-hmm. that like, yo, this dog, he just a grind. This is who Rashad Johnson is. And that's what kept it, man. You mean that 4-9 became iconic, team captain, two-time team captain, man. So anyway, that was my story of Rashad Johnson, man, and how you gained. Definitely, I respect, like, yo, this ain't going to be just no average walk-on. He's going to earn everything he get, man. And from then on, skies was the limit for you. So
I appreciate you, dog, so much, man. So, so much.
Absolutely, man, absolutely. Once again, so we're going to shut this thing down here, man. It's been – we could go on – I can go on for forever talking to my man. Man, taking us back.
Let me know. You know it.
Oh, what's that?
I said we can do this again, man. Just let me know. You know it.
Definitely, definitely, man. So we're going to definitely get you back on here. Appreciate you for your time here. Yo, this is my man, Rashad Johnson. Oh, we got to make sure they can get in contact with you. With Facebook, Rashad Johnson. Instagram, yeah. Rashad Johnson. Yeah. Right? All right. And yeah. How do you say they're going to get in contact with any type of speaking engagements or signings and things? What they need to go to? How they get in contact?
Yeah, info at walkonlife.com. So info at walk. walkonlife.com. Info at walkonlife.com. That's me.
There you go. You got it right there, man. My man Rashad Johnson here, 8-year Pro Bowler, All-American, University of Alabama. We signing out. It's your boy, E-Grade, for the E36 Unfiltered Podcast Show. Thank you. Peace. Love.
Yo, Chief, they can't stop me from rapping, can they? Can they hop? I spit it through the wire, man.